Good afternoon, my dear students. Today I am going to take a class on deep structures of neck. So by the deep structures of the neck, there are so many structures present in the neck. For example, the cervical viscera. Cervical viscera means these are some organs. So these are thyroid glands, some glands are present, thyroid gland, parathyroid, thymus, trachea, and esophagus. Last four cranial nerves, that is 19, 11, and 12 cranial nerves. Blood vessels, for example, carotids and subclavian arteries, then subclavian, internal jugular, and brachiocephalic veins. Lymphatics of the head and neck, this is another important topic. That's various glenoid muscles. Then in the prevertebral regions, you'll get the prevertebral muscles and paravertebral muscles. The cervical part of the sympathetic trunk, then cervical vertebra, intervertebral joints, and the craniovertebral joints. So these are the structures which are present. These are the structures which means the deep structures of the neck. Out of this, so many topics have been already covered, and few topics will be covered in the successive classes. For example, this thyroid gland is already taken in the previous class, and the nerves, that is the last four cranial nerves, this will be dealt in the different theory classes. Similarly, the lymphatics of the head and neck, that will be another theory class. And this cervical part of sympathetic trunk and prevertebral regions, this will be another theory class. And regarding the cervical vertebra and intervertebral joint, you will come to know in your osteology classes. So today's class, mainly I'll cover few of the structures present which are situated deep in the neck. Out of this, one important gland is the parathyroid gland. As you know, this parathyroid gland is responsible for a secretion of one hormone, that is the parathyroid hormone, which maintains the calcium level in the blood. So where does this parathyroid gland? These parathyroid glands, mainly there are four glands, two superior, these are the two superior parathyroid glands, and two inferior parathyroid glands. The superior parathyroid, where they are located? The superior parathyroid glands, they are almost constant in positions. They lie along the posterior border of the thyroid, middle part of the posterior border of the thyroid gland, where the inferior thyroid artery crosses the recurrent laryngeal nerve. The inferior, these are the two inferior parathyroid glands. These inferior parathyroid glands are variable in position. Sometimes they may lie below the loop of the inferior thyroid artery, but inside the thyroid capsule, and sometimes it is situated above the loop of the inferior thyroid artery, but outside the capsule of the thyroid gland. So this is the location, and the size is, it is about 6 millimeter in length, 4 millimeter in breadth, and 2 millimeter in thickness, and about 50 milligram in weight. So these are the dimensions of the parathyroid glands. So the parathyroid glands are supplied by the superior parathyroid artery and the inferior parathyroid artery. The superior parathyroid artery arises from the either from the anastomosis between the superior and the inferior as an anastomotic branch, from the anastomosis between the superior and the inferior thyroid artery, and the inferior parathyroid artery arises from the inferior thyroid artery. Then this gland is supplied by the sympathetic nerves. These sympathetic nerves are mainly fibers are coming from the superior and middle cervical ganglia. And mainly this is the secretion of the parathyroid gland mainly depends upon the blood calcium level. When the level of the calcium decreases, this gland is stimulated. So if you go into the histological structure of the parathyroid gland, you will see mainly main mass of the parathyroid gland is composed of principal cells or sieve cells, which is responsible for the secretion of the parathyroid hormone. Then another type of cell is present, that is the auxiphil cells, which comprises only a small portion of the gland. So this parathyroid hormone, it maintains the blood calcium level. How? By number one, by enhancing the mobilization of calcium from the bones by osteoclastic activity. Second is that it increases the reabsorption of calcium by proximal granule tubules. Then promoting the absorption of the dietary calcium from the small intestine. So these are the roles of the parathyroid hormone by which it maintains the blood calcium level. So two clinical conditions are associated with parathyroid gland. Number one is the hypoparathyroidism and second one is the hyperparathyroidism. Hypoparathyroidism, as the name implies, there is if there is removal of the parathyroid gland, it may occur spontaneously also, or if there is removal of the parathyroid gland during the thyroid surgery, so there will be no parathyroid hormone. As a result, the calcium level will be decreased in the body, and it will lead to a condition known as the tetany, which produces carpopedal spasm and convulsion. Then hyperparathyroidism. In hyperparathyroidism, if there is any tumor involving the parathyroid gland, there will be increased secretion of the parathyroid hormone. As a result, more calcium will be mobilized from the bone, making the bones very fragile and leading to a condition known as the osteitis fibrosa. So these are the two conditions related with the parathyroid gland. So another two important structures of the neck are trachea and the esophagus. This trachea has got two parts, cervical part and the thoracic part. Here I'll tell about the cervical part. As you know, this trachea is made up of 16 to 20 numbers of cartilaginous ring, and these cartilages are hyaline cartilage, and posteriorly the tracheal rings are deficient and it is bridged by one smooth muscle, that is trachealis. Why these rings are deficient posteriorly? Because just immediate posterior to the trachea, this esophagus is situated. So this allows smooth passage of food through the esophagus, and it allows the distension of esophagus during the passage of the food. And as you know, it is made up of 16 to 20 number of cartilaginous ring. This trachea begins from, it is the continuation of the larynx from the lower border of the cervical 6 vertebra up to the lower border of the thoracic 4 vertebra. That is the cervical part of the trachea. Next, if you see in the diagram, anteriorly the trachea, you see the skin, superficial fossa. After that, the investing layer of the deep cervical fascia, the sternohyoid muscle. This is the sternohyoid muscle. This is the sternothyroid muscles. And this, along with the deep investing layer of the deep cervical fascia, you'll get the enclosed sternocleidomastoid. And then the isthmus of the thyroid gland opposite the second, third, and fourth tracheal rings. And posterior to the trachea, you'll get the esophagus, then recurrent laryngeal nerve in the tracheoesophageal group, and on both sides you'll get the two lobes of the thyroid gland. And so this is about the relation of the cervical part of the trachea. Now coming to the esophagus, just posterior to the trachea, this is the esophagus. This esophagus is about 25 centimeter in length. This esophagus has got cervical part, thoracic part, and abdominal part. Here I'll be describing the cervical part only. So total length is about 25 centimeter. Anterior to the esophagus, this is the trachea and recurrent laryngeal nerve. On the both sides, you get the two lobes of the thyroid gland, and laterally also the internal carotid artery, a common carotid artery in the within the carotid set. And posteriorly, you will get the prevertebral fossa along with the prevertebral muscles and the vertebra. Regarding the dimension of the trachea, it is about 4 to 6 inches, that is about 11 centimeter in length. In male, it is I'm talking about the cervical part. In male, it is about 2 centimeter, and in female it is about 1.5 centimeter. And in a newborn child, it is a newborn baby, the length of the trachea, it is about only 3 millimeter. Why this dimension? And later on it goes on increasing. Why this dimension is important? Because if you go for endotracheal intubation, you have to insert the tube according to the diameter of the trachea. Then coming to the blood vessels, one important vessel, that is the subclavian artery. So this is the right subclavian artery, this is the left subclavian artery. These both two subclavian arteries, this right subclavian artery arises from the brachiocephalic trunk, and the left subclavian artery as arises directly from the arch of the aorta. Then these arteries behind the right subclavian artery, behind the right sternoclavicular joint, arches upwards and towards the right side over the your first rib. And then the left subclavian artery, which is a direct branch from the arch of the aorta, behind the sternoclavicular joint, it comes towards the neck and ultimately it arches over the cervical pleura and behind the scalenus anterior muscle and over the first rib. So here the course of the two, that is the right and the left subclavian arteries, are same. So this at the outer border of the first rib, both the subclavian artery becomes continue as a axillary artery. So the subclavian artery has got three parts. First part you see in the diagram. First part, that is from the origin to the medial border of the scalenus anterior muscle. Second part is behind the scalenus anterior muscle, and third part starting from the lateral part of the scalenus anterior muscle to the outer border of the first rib. So these are the three parts of the subclavian artery. What are the branches? So if you go first, what are the branches from the first part of the subclavian artery? That is the vertebral artery. This is the vertebral artery. Then internal thoracic artery. This is the thyrocervical trunk, from where you will get the inferior thyroid artery, transverse cervical artery, and the suprascapular artery. Then costocervical trunk, it is the fourth branch of the first part of the left subclavian artery. Then from the second part, on the right side, you will get the costocervical trunk. This is just behind the scalenus anterior muscle. And dorsal scapular artery, this is the dorsal scapular artery. This is the branch from the third part of the subclavian artery. So coming to the vertebral arteries, this is the vertebral artery. This vertebral artery arises from the first part of the subclavian artery. So as you have seen, this vertebral artery has got, this is the first part. It goes straight upwards. Then it enters through the foramen transversium of the upper six cervical vertebra. This is the vertebral portion. This is the second part of the vertebral artery. Then this is the, after coming out from the foramen transversarium of the first cervical vertebra, it goes upwards along the lateral mass of the first cervical vertebra, and here it lies within the suboccipital triangle. So this is the third part of the vertebral artery. Then it enters through the foramen magnum. So this is the fourth part of the vertebral artery. Then on entering the cranial cavity, it joins with the vertebral artery of the opposite side to form the basilar artery. So there are four parts of the vertebral artery. First part, second part, this is the third part, and this is the fourth part. Now coming to the cervical part of the vertebral artery, mainly it gives some muscular branches and spinal branches. Muscular branches supplies the muscles of the neck, and the spinal branches, it comes out through the foramen transversarium and enters the vertebral canal through the intervertebral foramen and supplies the upper six cervical segments of the spinal cord. So as I have described you previously regarding the two subclavian artery, and you have come to know regarding the branches of the subclavian artery, there is one syndrome known as the subclavian still syndrome. Here what happens, if there is thrombosis of the subclavian artery proximal to the origin of the vertebral artery, then what will happen? See here, this is the right subclavian artery, this is the left subclavian artery. So there is thrombus. So what will happen? The blood from the left right subclavian artery, it will enter the right vertebral artery. Then some of the blood will be shunted in a retrograde fashion towards the left vertebral artery. That means some of the blood before going to the brain, it will come from the unaffected side to the affected side. So here you have seen left side is affected. That is why blood is coming from the right vertebral artery and entering towards the left vertebral artery and ultimately into the left subclavian artery. That means some of the blood is still from the unaffected. There is stealing of blood by the affected site. So this is the subclavian still syndrome. So what are the other branches of the subclavian artery? That is the internal thoracic artery, thoracervical trunk, and costocervical trunk. Internal thoracic artery, here again you see this diagram. Internal thoracic artery, this is the internal thoracic artery. This internal thoracic artery ultimately enters the thorax and it enters, goes downwards up to the sixth intercostal space. Then third branch is the thyrocervical trunk. This thyrocervical trunk, it divides into here in the diagram, as you have seen, it gives a inferior thyroid artery, transverse cervical artery, and the suprascapular artery. So these are the three branches. Then coming to the costocervical trunk. So this is the costocervical trunk. This costocervical trunk, immediately after the origin, it arches above the cervical pleura and just at the gap between the transverse process of the cervical 7 vertebra and the neck of the first rib, it divides into deep cervical artery. This goes towards the neck region, and another is the superior highest intercostal artery. The superior highest intercostal artery, after coming between the neck of the first and the second rib, it divides into two branches and gives off the posterior intercostal artery to the first two intercostal spaces. So these are the branches. And another is the from the third part of the subclavian artery, dorsal scapular artery, that you already know. This dorsal scapular artery goes towards the medial border of the scapula and ultimately it takes part in the formation of the arterial anastomosis around the scapula. So what are the clinical correlation? So cervical rib may compress the subclavian artery as it passes through the gap between the scalenus anterior and scalenus medius muscles. So any reason, it may develop in the third part of the subclavian artery. So the upper limb on the affected side will be, there will be ischemia of the upper limb on the affected side. This visual dysuria, it is a condition in which there is right subclavian artery sometimes may arise from the descending thoracic aorta and it compresses the esophagus. So there is difficulty in swelling. So that condition is known as the dysphagia lusoria. Then coming to the veins. So subclavian vein, as in the diagram you have seen, this subclavian vein, it is the continuation of the axillary vein at the outer border of the first rib, and it arches over the first rib and the cervical pleura, and ultimately it joins with the internal jugular vein to form the brachiocephalic vein. So just this arch of, as in the diagram you see, this subclavian vein, arch of the subclavian vein lies a little bit downwards below the loop of the subclavian artery, and from where it is separated by the scalenus anterior muscle and the phrenic nerve. So this is the, here you can see, this is the loop of the subclavian vein. Then another is the internal jugular vein. This internal jugular vein, this is the direct continuation of the sigmoid sinus. So this is the right internal jugular vein, this is the left internal jugular vein. So right internal jugular vein, it is the continuation of the right sigmoid sinus, which is in turn is the continuation of the superior sagittal sinus, and left internal jugular vein, it is the continuation of the left sigmoid sinus, which in turn is the continuation of the inferior sagittal sinus. That is why the right internal jugular vein is larger than the left one, as it drains mainly the comparatively larger superior sagittal sinus. Then this comes downwards straight and it joins with the right subclavian vein to form the brachiocephalic vein. So here you will see two bulbs or swelling. One is the superior bulb right at the commencement of the right internal both internal jugular veins, superior bulbs of the internal jugular vein, and another one at the terminal portion where it joins with the subclavian vein. So see, these are the two bulbs. One is the superior bulb, another is the inferior bulb. So this internal jugular vein acts as a guide for the surgeons during removal of the deep cervical lymph nodes. This vein is safely cannulated by inserting a needle at the apex of the supraclavicular fossa. Then a little bit about the prevertebral muscles. What are the prevertebral muscles? One is the rectus capitis anterior. So this is the rectus capitis anterior. It arises from the anterior surface of the lateral mass of the first cervical vertebra. Then it goes upward and inserted into the base occiput. Then this is the rectus capitis lateralis. It arises from the anterior surface of the transverse process of the first cervical vertebra. It goes laterally and it is attached to the occiput. Then you see this is the longus coli muscle. It has got three parts: superior oblique part, middle vertical part, and inferior oblique part. The superior oblique part arises from the anterior tubercle of the transverse process of the third and the fourth cervical vertebra. It goes upwards and attaches to the anterior surface of the lateral mass of the first cervical vertebra. Then middle vertical part arises from the upper lower three cervical vertebra and from the body of the upper three thoracic vertebra. And this fibers goes upwards and it is attached to the body of the cervical as well as the upper three thoracic vertebra. Then third part, that is the inferior oblique part, it arises from the body of the first three thoracic vertebra and the fibers goes laterally and it is inserted into the anterior tubercle of the cervical 5 and 6 vertebra. So with this I would like to conclude, and there are other important structures in the which are located in the deep region of the neck, which I'll continue in the next class. Till then, stay safe. Thank you.